Welcome to Talking Kotlin, the second episode that we have now in our new YouTube format. I'm once again here with my co-host, Hadi. Hadi, how are you?
I thought you were going to say you're here with your neon lights. I got to get some neon lights. I need to look as awesome as you do. And I got to remember this time to look at the camera. Last time I was like looking at you, which you're not on the camera. But I'm good. How are you, Seb?
Everything is fine. There's a lot of cool Kotlin content to be made. And I think we should start that in this episode as well.
So Wait, hold on.
Yeah.
Wait, what? We're not going to talk about the weather?
I know that this is kind of the whole...
It's like the whole Talking Kotlin thing, you know? Like, talk about the weather?
Yeah. I mean, you want to talk about the weather? How's the weather?
No, screw the weather. Let's talk about the virus. No, screw the virus as well. No, let's talk about Kotlin. Who's our guest today?
Yeah. Do you want to answer that for us? No, I'm going to answer
that. I'm asking you.
Yeah, so today we got John O'Reilly here today with us. He's an Android software engineer at Neat, and he's also a Google developer expert for Kotlin. Welcome, John.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me on, guys. Nice to sort of meet you in person, I guess, or as much as face-to-face as we can these days.
Yeah, so far it's only been Twitter messages and GitHub issues for the two of us, I think.
Exactly.
I think this is one of the cool things of us moving to YouTube is that you can actually say you've met us. Well, I mean, we meet each other, right? Which is literally just looking at each other. Yeah. I know you've only said a few words, so I'm going to guess here. I'm going to go out on a limb. O'Reilly, is that by chance Irish?
Yeah, how did you guess?
I watch way too many movies.
Yeah. I sometimes get asked, you know, are you in any way related to the publishing house? You know, I wish I was.
You killed conferences. You are part of the You are part of the reason that O'Reilly killed conferences.
Oh no. Well, let's actually introduce maybe the topic of today, because even though you are an Android engineer, what you do actually kind of goes quite far beyond just Android development. We're actually planning to talk a little bit more about all things Kotlin multi-platform with you, because you've been doing a lot in that space as well. But actually, I mean, you've been doing a lot of development work in general for a long time. You want to kind of like give us the short history, the highlights, so that people kind of know who you are?
I'm always sort of wary in this sort of discussion that I don't sound like one of these, you know, back in my day, you know, we walked barefoot into, you know, we were lucky to have shoes sort of thing. But I've been, I suppose, working professionally for over 30 years now. As a hobby even before that. Over that time, working across a range of sort of different industries and domains. I spent my sort of career, as I sort of sometimes mention, conveniently lines up along decade boundaries. So I think I spent the 90s working on desktop development here in Ireland, lived and worked in the US and the UK for a while. Came back to Ireland in 2000, just as the .com bubble was about to burst. Somehow got a server-side Java development job. This is the time when you didn't really have to have the skills in the area you were being hired in. They gave me a job. So that sort of started a decade of server-side Java development. And then in the company I was in, joined in 2008, a project I was on 2 years later in 2010 got canceled. And one of my colleagues in San Jose got put in charge of this new team development for this thing called Android. And he said, hey, do you want to join up? You know, and so that was the start of my sort of, there's a lot of serendipity, I suppose, and sort of chance occurrences, but that was the start of my Android career. And that was the start actually of working. I've been working remotely full time ever since then as well.
So you are basically as probably around my age, more or less in the same line. Like both of us, this is the point where both of us can say, Seb, you weren't even born when we were programming. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just saying. That probably checks out. Exactly.
I regularly work with people who were born after I graduated, you know, so you have to sort of put that to the side. I mean, you can't, you know, particularly when technology is changing so fast and you're working in an area that the person so much younger than you may even have, you know, frequently has more experience than you have in that area. So you don't get too focused on your age or experience. Of
you hear that, Hadi?
I'm not focused on my age. I appreciate every single piece of white hair that I have. I've worked hard for this. Three kids.
Yeah,
but anyway.
Likewise.
Yeah, John, I got to ask you a question. Regarding desktop and server side, what did you start in? Like, what technologies were you using?
So it's interesting. So as I said, a lot of serendipity. So when I finished college in 1990, I started a sort of full-time master's doing speech recognition using neural networks of all things. Back then, that was sort of, you could do that out of the box. I was watching the Kotlin DL talk yesterday where a couple of lines of code, I can do that. But this was sort of writing everything from scratch in C in terms of audio processing, FFTs, and the neural network implementation themselves. And there was a need for something kind of graphical. And I had done some DOS development for a while. And so Windows 3 came out, I think, around June 1990. And I said, oh, this looks cool. You know, I can sort of do some Windows graphical, you know, UIs for my speech patterns and my neural networks and so forth. And again, more chance occurrences. A local company was sort of starting to do Windows development and said, hey, you know, obviously not too many people doing it at that stage. And said, hey, do you want to join us? So I sort of, that sort of started the decade of doing Windows C, transitioning to C++, Windows SDK, MFC, COM, ATL.
MFC, wow.
Yeah, the usual thing.
I remember those.
Yeah, and it's funny because obviously I've been toying with Compose for desktop right now, and there's sort of a little bit of a sort of, I don't know what you call it.
Throwback?
Yeah. Throwbacks to sort of desktop development a little bit. So it's funny.
what's old is new again. So when did you actually start with developing Kotlin then?
So I'm trying to think. I guess it was the announcement at Google I/O in about 5 years ago now, is it? I can't remember. Anyway, so there was an announcement at Google at Kotlin. To be honest, I hadn't. I know a lot of people had been aware of Kotlin at that stage and were very excited about it. I was a little bit in the dark. It was something quite new to me. I hadn't been that much aware of it. And I suppose it's a good segue to another point. I suppose, you know, as in most companies, we probably weren't in a position to start using Kotlin straight away, you know. And what I have, and I have an application in the Play Store called Galway Bus. It's an open source project. It has an app. Hopefully people find somewhat useful that actually does. But for me personally, I sort of use it. I overload it somewhat in terms of as a platform to try out new technologies. So when the Android architecture components came out, first of all, I used it to sort of try those out. And then when Kotlin emerged, I sort of start gradually migrating that to Kotlin. And you know, similarly with Kotlin Multiplatform down the road a little bit. And then, you know, as is frequently the case, trying that out there then became a platform to say, okay, now in the workplace, okay, this looks interesting. Let's start to use this here. And then shortly after that, then, you know, maybe a year down the road after the announcement, maybe we start to use it at work. And we start to use it gradually in a particular project. And then we ended up doing a kind of, for various reasons, we did a complete rewrite of our project. And we started from the ground up then. It was Kotlin, all Kotlin, Android architecture components, coroutines, and so forth. So
was this your first kind of multi-platform project or not?
So the at that stage, I wasn't using Kotlin Multiplatform, I guess, at work. And the Galway Bus app sort of had, I suppose to give, a little bit more background there, like, as I said, I've sort of been working on mobile for about 11 years now. And I guess over that period of time, like many of us, we would have seen a sort of succession of cross-platform. I guess, there's always a sort of cross-platform versus multi-platform, but cross-platform, as I kind of understand it, is sort of write once sort of approaches, the app accelerator, or React Native approaches. And, over the course of various projects in the previous company I was in, a new product manager, somebody would come in and they'd have read some headline saying, this allows you to do everything in one place. You can write all your code in one place. We don't need to have all these separate iOS and Androids. And each time you'd have sort of had to, the burden of proof, I guess, was on us to sort of prove that, particularly working on video conferencing applications. And we had to prove that this wasn't suitable for the type of applications we were developing and the sort of platform integrations we needed and the user experience we needed. But I'm saying that, I suppose, as a segue to, I guess what got me interested in Kotlin Multiplatform, because when Kotlin Multiplatform, at least when I was aware of it, I think around 2018, towards the end of that, it sort of immediately struck me as, okay, this is a pragmatic, sane approach, finally, to the sharing of code, across multiple platforms, mobile. And I'd been involved also, by the way, in sort of a number of initiatives over the years for pulling in C++ shared code into mobile and desktop, which, it's at least a somewhat more sane approach. But I don't know if you guys have worked with JNI or had to work with JNI,
I've been fortunate enough.
No, don't.
Yeah. I feel like that's one of those topics that if you can, you usually avoid it, I guess.
Yeah. And if you can avoid using it as well, we had to, there were areas we had to use it, and there are practical reasons why you have to use it. And it's one thing using, I think, as a sort of a stateless library that does a particular function, as we do for maybe a media engine, for example.
I just wanted to say on the topic of JNI, I think this is going to become a bit more interesting again now, also with all the topics around Compose for desktop, because a bunch of like system integrations, I don't know, things like global hotkeys or stuff, the JVM just doesn't really expose. So I think some of the people at the forefront there wanting to write libraries, they might might have to go that route anyway.
Yeah, and you know, in fairness, if you're using it for sort of what you might call a stateless library that does pick a function, I think is one thing. But using a complete shared logic with the framework, with the threading involved, with the lifecycle aspects of that is a different story completely. You know, debugging, crash reports, all that sort of stuff. So having gone through that, and I suppose having seen the sort of attempts at sort of pulling in and sort of pushing us towards cross-platform frameworks, Kotlin Multiplatform sort of just was just immediately, you know, like the fact that it was Kotlin, the fact that we were using Kotlin, you know, obviously was an advantage, it was a positive from my perspective. But more generally, I think it was a sane approach. You know, it was targeting shared logic. It was it had a kind of a mechanism, I suppose, or a capability in place where you could sort of, and this is critical, you could incrementally adopt it. You know, you could start pulling it in for some small area. And I think the general advice today still is that you start doing that. You sort of move it in. You take some particular business logic, maybe a remote API endpoint access or so forth, and then gradually build up from there. And you know, there's another kind of whole discussion point around how you socialize that and how you get, in particular, iOS developers interested and accepting of this approach. But, you know, that's the topic in itself. But certainly from that perspective, at least, I think it's very important to start small. And as I said, the key thing about Kotlin Multiplatform appealed at that point was that it had that capability, that it lended itself to that sort of adoption.
So just to kind of to recap your point, you feel that the main difference between Kotlin Multiplatform and these other cross-platform toolkits is what exactly? That you can adopt them incrementally, that you stay away from UI. What part would you say is kind of the most interesting here?
There's quite a few different aspects, I think, and cutting across a couple of different areas. You know, on one hand, I think, you know, if you've been involved in cross-platform at all, you're very familiar with Kevin Galligan and sort of, you know, one of the sort of primary advocates and you know, of this for some time. And I think he describes it as a sort of from a perspective of risk management as well. You know, you're trying to avoid lock-in. Obviously, I think one key differentiator among other, there's a number of them, I think, but one key differentiator is if you decide to use React Native or you use Flutter or you use, you know, a variety of other approaches that have been there over the years, there's a strong element of lock-in. And you know, it's an all or nothing sort of approach, really. With Kotlin Multiplatform, it allows you to manage the risk. You know, you can sort of pull in gradually and start using it. Then the flip side of that then is, and this sort of touches on a couple of areas, obviously, but focus on shared business logic. You know, as an iOS, as an Android developer, I want to use the best of breed technologies, IDEs, capabilities I can. I want to use SwiftUI on iOS. I want to use Combine, the reactive framework there. Likewise on Android with Kotlin and, you know, coroutines and Flow and so forth. And that's the key difference here. You know, that focus. I think it touches on another area. I think we've got to sort of a certain level of maturity, I think, with Kotlin Multiplatform, where I think it's a good sign in some regards that we've gone beyond, okay, this is proof of concept, you know, what's it about? We're now sort of digging in deeper into sort of architectures and different approaches you can use. And I think this is, it's a little bit of a sort of a simplistic way maybe, but I sometimes mention, you know, quote as, just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do something. So I think we have to be careful, you know, its main sort of selling point is its focus on shared logic. You know, I see a lot of discussions are sort of pushing up further up the stack, you know, to the view model, and potentially, you know, you hear in the context of Compose nowadays, of course, why can't we do Compose for iOS? You know, and I think there's a danger, to be honest, you can't generalize too much. There's a danger of going too far up, and then it just becomes another cross-platform framework, I think, you know, our approach in general. You know, the key selling point, and particularly if you get into the discussion around how you socialize this and how you get buy-in from other teams, you know, is that it has that focus and that it continues to have that focus, I think.
Do you feel like teams understand, or I mean, not in general teams, but people understand the concept of shared logic? Because I felt, at least, you know, initially, that folks, when you were talking about shared logic, they would focus on a specific thing, which is like business logic, right? And not think that I can actually share other things. I could share maybe, you know, abstractions over logging, abstractions over other types of aspects of my application that isn't specifically about the business logic. Have you encountered that? Do you think that that's still something that people get confused with when we talk about this multi-platform and common code approach?
Yeah, I maybe to a degree. I think the other way, I suppose, it's sometimes labeled, I suppose, as a non-UI code. I think that's maybe a little bit more, you know, informative.
Indicative, right.
Indicative, yeah. And you know, just in terms of what you just mentioned there, I think another very good example I see sometimes, I've seen a few people mention is analytics, for example, you know. And in the context also of the socialization aspect of saying, okay, what are, as an iOS developer, what are the areas that you don't really enjoy working on? what are the things that, you know, that you'd like to sort of, you'd be very happy to have sort of somebody provide a sort of your shared code for you, you know, to use maybe some core data interaction that you're doing, you know, now I can, somebody can write this sort of, you know, this can be done in SQL Delight, for example, in a shared code. And you don't need to worry about that. You know, I work, over the last 11 years, I've worked very closely with the iOS developers on the various projects I've been on. And they're typically, almost without fail, very passionate about what they do. They're very focused on, you know, the latest, greatest. They want to create very compelling user experience. They want to use the best, latest tools available to them. They're working in an environment on iOS, which tends to move a little bit faster than Android in terms of adoption. And they want to be able to pull in and use the latest capabilities. So I think that this is where, you know, it's very important how you phrase this and how you manage this. You know, I think if you focus on areas that are sort of non-platform specific, to a large degree, and areas that are sort of just not that much fun, maybe not, you could describe as maybe not that much fun to work on. And not to put off people trying, you know, when I say not much fun, I'm sorry, I don't want to sort of put off people working. but maybe just from the perspective of a UI developer who's focused on creating compelling user experience.
So I actually want to shift the topic a little bit of this discussion, because so the way that I actually got to know you and all the stuff you do all around Kotlin, well, once of all, it's your Twitter account, of course. I still don't know how you managed to tweet about our blog posts before we managed to do it from the official accounts, even when we have like a 3-minute delay. Actually, you want to share how you do that? Like,
actually, the last time around, I think we were joking about this on Twitter. I think the last time around, I was a little bit conscious of that. I saw a thing and I said, okay, I'm going to wait a bit longer this time. So I'll give them a chance. And I think you purposely held off a bit longer this time. But, and finally, I can't wait any longer. I'll tweet it. But yeah, I clearly spend way too much time on Twitter. So yeah.
Yeah, I think I've seen you do that with Ktor times as well. It's like we're in the process of releasing, and you're like, you know, the stuff is on Maven, but I don't see a blog post. So I'm like, wait a second.
Yeah, it's nice to keep finger on the pulse, maybe a bit too close to the pulse, maybe. But yeah.
No, it's great, so, actually.
Yeah, so if you want to get really, really up to date information, make sure to follow John at J O'Reilly, I believe. Yeah. On Twitter, where you get
that's not Tim
things.
O'Reilly, that's Jay O'Reilly.
yeah, but the other part, how I of course got in touch with your work is your GitHub account, where you have a bunch of different examples for Kotlin and especially Kotlin Multiplatform. Do you want to like tell us a little bit about the stuff you have on there?
Yeah, absolutely. I suppose just to give, I suppose the primary one, or the one that I sort of started off with was people in space. And I mean, just to sort of give a little bit of history of that. And, you know, I suppose the focus for me has been the combination of Kotlin Multiplatform and declarative UI. I think that's sort of the critical, not the critical, but sort of the compelling combination, what I think is a real productivity sweet spot we're sort of converging on. And I'd mentioned sort of the Go Away Bus application, and I sort of had used that as a platform to try out Kotlin Multiplatform when it came out. And I think, you know, in the context of declarative UI, I'd been at Google I/O, I think, in 2018 or 19, actually, I guess, when Compose was announced. And I'd like to say in retrospect, you know, that, there was an aha moment. I went, okay, well, this is something really interesting, you know, groundbreaking moment. But it didn't really strike me at that point. It wasn't really available to try out. And I'm very much someone who needs to code and to sort of, you know, to sort of prove something out. And so it didn't really register that much. But then a couple of weeks later, I was watching I was watching WWDC and they announced Swift UI. And what was interesting there was that they actually, you could download an Xcode beta immediately, pretty much. And so straight away downloaded it. Several hours later, in the early hours of the morning, I had sort of got to a good point with this sort of Kotlin multi-platform code, where it was sort of, you know, I run into various issues, and it was working pretty well at that point. So I guess as an Android developer, you know, when you're opening up Xcode and you're trying to get an iOS development, you know, you're not doing that frequently. And I sort of struggled with storyboards and view controllers, and Swift UI was immediately, okay, wow, even more so than a Compose to some extent. First of all, seeing that announced was a sort of a validation that declarative UI was something here to say, something I should pay attention to. But more so, it was really approachable from as an Android developer that I could very easily put an iOS UI together. So I created something with that, and I worked with that for a while. But as I said, it was sort of unwieldy. And coming towards the end of 2019, I thought, okay, I really need to create. There wasn't really that many samples around. And I wanted to create something that really sort of got across. I saw a lot of confusion around what Kotlin Multiplatform was. I saw a lot of people struggling with sort of getting dependencies right. Back then and today, even to some extent, it's always a little bit problematic getting the right versions, the right combinations, the right Gradle configuration. So I thought, let me try and create something that I would have found useful. And sort of somewhat serendipitously, I think coming up to Christmas in 2019, I don't know if you know Ken Kusin, you probably do, he sort of tweets a lot about Java and Kotlin now. He wrote this very interesting short article about, you know, example of using Kotlin and using it. I think he was using Retrofit at the time. But he used this endpoint to get the people in space, the list of people in space. You know, it was a very, very simple endpoint, as you can imagine. And this sort of immediately struck me, okay, this was perfect. This fitted perfectly with what I was trying to get from this. I wanted something, this word I overuse, probably minimal. I wanted a minimal project that you could see at a glance. You could, you know, there was very little noise there. You could see at a glance what the key moving parts of Kotlin Multiplatform project was. You could open it up, run it. And you say, okay, that's what it's about. And you know, sort of just slight tangent here. I mean, when you know, you guys obviously know very well about sort of developer advocacy, you know, and I think when you talk about it, I mean, there's multiple stages, you know, where we were at and where we are some sort of Kotlin Multiplatform, you need something that addresses a point where someone just wants to get a flavor of something. They see there's something called Kotlin Multiplatform. Maybe they're not about to use it. They want to know what it's about, what the capability provides. And there's a need at that point to provide something that abstracts maybe some of the complexities. You know, you don't need to, in the context of Kotlin Multiplatform, you don't need to initially get into Kotlin native concurrency model, for example. You know, if somebody just wants to try out and understand what Kotlin Multiplatform is about, you don't want to really sort of pull them down that that road too much that they don't need to at that point. So anyway, so People in Space was born out of that then. It was sort of just a very simple project that I tried to cut down to as much as I could, the bare minimum, to get across, you know, what it was about. And it seemed to strike a chord. I think it was just came at a good time in terms of people's, you know, that people were starting to explore Kotlin Multiplatform.
And this actually leads me to something I want to ask you that I've been recently discussing, and Seb's aware of this. It's in regards to wizards. And I tweeted a couple of days ago about how important do you think a wizard is. And to clarify, when I'm talking about a wizard, you can use it on the command line with npm install or start.spring.io or start.ktor.io, whatever, right? It's essentially of something that allows you to generate and get up and running. Okay, now, from a perspective of someone evaluating the technology, like you say, that I just want to start something and get it up and running, how important do you think this is? And secondly, apart from the learning aspect of it, do you think that it's important that people have this template every time they want to start a new project?
Yeah, I think, again, it comes down to the sort of stage people are at, I think, to some extent. You know, I think you need to provide different things to address the different stages people are at in terms of their initial sort of exploration and then starting to use it perhaps for the first time in anger, so to speak. I think this is an interesting, like, so Kotlin Multiplatform ecosystem, I mean, there was, of course, I guess how long, maybe 6 months ago, is it? There was a sort of somewhat of a rebranding around Kotlin Multiplatform Mobile, KMM. It's still effectively a, you know, Kotlin Multiplatform, but I think obviously it's focused on the key aspect of sharing code on mobile. And part of that was a Kotlin Multiplatform plugin, which more and more people are starting to use. You know, and it gives you the ability to sort of create a basic starting point. I mean, something that I guess was missing, I guess something maybe, you know, if that was around maybe the time People in Space was created, there wouldn't have been as much, I guess, maybe need for that, or it wouldn't maybe have sort of been something people would have used as much because they would have had this capability. But certainly, you know, that plugin has been a great sort of addition. But I think if you think about, I suppose, in the context of how Kotlin Multiplatform can continue to improve and sort of mature, I think that's one area that I definitely think there'd be huge value in. You know, taking that Kotlin Multiplatform plugin, saying, okay, right now it produces a very sort of basic, I don't know, Hello World, I can't even remember, sort of Hello World type multiplatform project. But how about saying, okay, well, I want to use Ktor, I want to use SQL, I want to use Kotlin X serialization, I want to use SQL Delight. Maybe you use some third-party endpoint, or maybe JetBrains hosts various endpoints, for example, and you say, okay, I'll pick this example endpoint. You give a list of maybe five or six endpoints with associated data model around those. And you say, this looks like an interesting sort of starting point for me. So something real, something that's not just sort of like a Hello World, but I think there would be huge value in having something like that in Kotlin Multiplatform that brought in those dependencies, that brought in the right versions of those dependencies. For example, maybe as part of that wizard, you could pick, okay, for whatever reason, I still can't move to Kotlin 1.4.30, I'm on 1.4.21, for example. So you pull in the right combination of dependencies that work with that version of Kotlin. and likewise. And then someone has a starting point, and they can change that around as they need to do. I guess, which is what people are doing with, I guess, a lot of these templates right now. Obviously, you know, along with the ones I have, you know, obviously Touch Labs have some very good ones as well, like CampKit, that people, I guess, are typically will, you know, I hope people aren't starting Kotlin multi-platform projects from scratch these days. You know, I think it's a sort of, I do see people, by the way, who seem to be doing that, but I strongly recommend starting with a template. It can be sort of problematic, particularly starting off getting everything right.
Well, what I personally, also where I see a lot of value for the templates that you and other folks have built, is that they give you some kind of opinionated approach. Because when you just start with the technology, it's kind of hard. Like, a lot of questions come up about, am I supposed to do this? Can I do this? Is someone going to shun me if I do this? When you have a little bit of code that someone else has written, it already gives you a little bit of confidence in this regard. So I think this is quite interesting. On the same note, actually, have you found that there are any particular architectural patterns, for example, that are well suited to the multi-platform world specifically, especially considering that everything's kind of a declarative UI framework out there these days?
Yeah, it's interesting, and I think that's one of the appeals, just to some extent, of the declarative UI approaches. I think it gives a very clear separation of concerns. You know, it sort of enforces almost a certain architectural style. You know, in terms of the way, you know, what people, like, I sort of joked about this a little bit on Twitter the other day, like, sort of tongue in cheek, but people talk about unidirectional data flow. I sort of sometimes think these sort of labels are a little bit sometimes grandiose, things that we probably are doing anyway. But certainly, the likes of declarative UI forces a certain style in terms of, you know, sometimes people call MVI, unidirectional data flow, having sort of a sealed class representing your UI state, which is emitted from a view model, for example. So I think there's still a lot of scope. I mean, having said that, and again, sort of just as a good segue to a point about Kotlin multi-platform, I think, is it doesn't force you down a particular path in terms of your architecture. And that's a critical aspect. I think, you know, there's scope. In the examples that I have, typically there's a sort of nominal repository class, and there's a sort of a class representing a remote API endpoint, and then obviously it's using something for persistence. You know, if you're using sort of clean architecture, you might have a use case layer, for example, and the use case layer could very well belong in your shared code as well. Where things get a little bit, maybe an overstatement to call it controversial, is, I suppose, is where the view model resides. You know, I think if you are using a view model, there's some discussion around, okay, well, maybe declarative UI, you don't need to use a view model. I think a lot of scenarios, I think you still need something that fits that function. And I tend to sort of, in any of my examples so far, I've kept the view model in the native tier, I guess, native layer. I see a lot of examples and people pushing towards using the view model in shared code as well. And you can do that. I mean, that's the great thing, is it? But it has implications around one of the things when you talk about sort of development and the maturity of Kotlin multi-platform. One thing I think one area that I think would like to see some improvement would be, or I hope that there will be improvement around, is things like scope management, coroutine. You know, how we Kotlin 1.4, for example, gave you the ability to call suspend functions directly, you know, in shared code. There's still a sort of unknown around flow. How do I manage flow, for example? You know, how do I map to a combined publisher, for example, and there's implications then around who manages the coroutine scope. There's the structured concurrency aspects of that, and there's critically there's the lifecycle aspects of that, because at some point you need to tie that into the lifecycle of your mobile application. So those kind of things are sort of, I think, still up in the air a little bit, and I think how they develop a little bit will give people more options in terms of how, you know, where they can target the shared code.
And I want to touch, I think we should touch up on Compose a little bit, and also Ktor, because, yeah, Ktor! But to kind of wrap up a little bit, multi-platform, where do you see the ecosystem? I mean, one of the things that, I don't know if you're aware of that package search functionality that we have in IntelliJ IDEA that we created also, which is one of the reasons that was born was my own frustration with trying to find dependencies and libraries for Kotlin. Right, especially coming from another ecosystem. We're not there yet. We still want to try and improve the experience. But how do you see the overall ecosystem? What do you think is kind of like missing for multi-platform to really take off, if you will?
Yeah, so I mentioned about the wizard, I think. I think something like that. I think the plugin is probably, I'm not even sure what the roadmap is, but certainly I can imagine there's a roadmap of sort of functionality that people want to add to that plugin. I think as that expands, I think that will be very useful. Well, of course, the other dynamic is we're seeing more and more libraries available for Kotlin Multiplatform. That's a critical aspect. You know, that's going to obviously put people in. You know, if there's one thing I suppose that in the earlier days maybe it gave people pause for thought a little bit was maybe, okay, they couldn't do this or they couldn't do that. For example, the Kotlin Multiplatform, there wasn't the various libraries. Now there's a ton of libraries. I mean, coding open, you know, have this DB, what am I trying to say? NoSQL database that runs there, for example. I've been trying out the GraphQL, the Apollo GraphQL, which runs in Kotlin Multiplatform. There's sort of DI frameworks now available, Coin and coding. You know, so there's a wider range. I think, I can't remember, I think it was who mentioned this earlier in a there was a talk the other day, and they had given a version of that talk sort of maybe a year before, and they had one slide which showed all the Kotlin Multiplatform libraries, and they said, no, they obviously can't do that anymore. It definitely doesn't fit on a single slide either. There's a much wider range of libraries available now. So that's that sort of thing. And I suppose, you know, as I mentioned about the sort of, I think that there's a lot, somewhat confusion, I suppose, and maybe around the interaction between, I think on the roadmap, I don't know where it is in the roadmap right now, but there's sort of native Swift support, I think, would be interesting. Right now, obviously, you go through this sort of Objective-C mapping. And then I think Kotlin Native, there's scope for Kotlin Native to expand in terms of, like, they did add this capability where you could call, you know, submit functions directly. But I think there's scope for some code generation there around flows, for example. You know, the mapping of the creation of a scope, the some hooks to manage that and to cancel it and to map it. Even as I said, you know, there's one of the guys from Touch Labs did a sort of a blog article last year where they mapped a Kotlin flow to an Rx Swift, for example. I did a similar exploration recently where I was using Combine Publisher. And there are things I think that could potentially be generated automatically, you know, based on a particular annotation. I think there's sort of, it's plumbing, what would you call it? Plumbing code that could just be added as an example, at least, even if people weren't to use it. And then it becomes, because that's the thing. I mean, a lot of these, the danger of some of these things, particularly, you know, I'm probably guilty of the same thing. Some of these samples is they're a little bit toyish and they go so far. But practically, you know, most applications these days need to consume a Kotlin flow, for example, as I said. And something that makes that easier in a multi-platform environment, I think, would help a lot.
Yeah, and if you're developing libraries, just make sure you don't host them on JCenter.
Yeah.
Minor little thing there. Yeah. Like the whole world is collapsing now.
Yeah.
Global climate change? Yeah, screw that. We got JCenter going down.
So if you had the option to kind of call out to the community and tell them to build one more multi-platform library, do you see some kind of space where people could still innovate? Besides adapters for concurrency?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I guess, most of the general purpose areas are kind of pretty well addressed right now. If, you know, if you want to make a remote API request, you want to do serialized, deserialized JSON. There's persistence, obviously, capabilities with SQLite and now CodingDB, for example. We see things like KotlinX, datetime, you know, experimental libraries. That was a kind of an important one, I think, that's available now. File.io, I guess, is something that's kind of developing as well. I think I saw that OKHTTP has a multi-platform version now as well. So, you know, once you've got the key bases covered there, I think you start getting into more domain-specific, I guess, you know, I suppose. But I think we're close to a critical point, where the sort of the key common use cases are addressed and there's capabilities there that you can use.
Well, I'm gonna throw Hadi a bone here because you said that there's a way to do HTTP requests quite nicely in Kotlin multiplatform. Is there a specific library that you've been working with here, or that you would like to recommend? Maybe
I'm trying to remember what that is. No, I'm all joking aside. I'm a big fan of Ktor. I think it's sort of. You know, used obviously like many people who use retrofit in the past, use other approaches. And thanks.
I'm late, but that's what you were gonna say, right?
This is a visual joke for our listeners. Hadi just put up a piece of paper with the word Ktor on it.
Oh yes, of course, because we have listeners on the podcast, which is still happening. And if you haven't checked out the YouTube, where you can see Seb's amazing neon lights and my gray hair. Check us out on YouTube as well. And this segment has been brought to you by Talking Kotlin Promotions. Anyway, John, anyway, you were saying.
Yeah. So, I'm a big fan of Ktor. I mean, I suppose I would have used Ktor, started off the Kotlin, and then more recently I've been using it on the sort of server side, so to speak. And, you know, both of them obviously take advantage of Kotlin's DSL type approach, I think, which is very nice, you know, particularly on the server, more so, I think. Building a Kotlin client, or building a client that uses Ktor is almost trivial at this stage, to be honest. You know, it's a couple of lines of code in many cases to sort of, you know, hit an endpoint, get your Kotlin externalization typically, you know, mapping over. On the server, I've been more, you know, I've used it a bit more, and I guess you sort of, things like installing features that you can add, you know, that DSL approach just makes it very, very nice, you know. And time again, we've kind of come across a particular thing that we needed to do and wonder whether, and it turned out there was a feature that we could install to do that. And it was a very pleasant experience using it on both client and server. But certainly, yeah. And this, I suppose, actually, even on the client side, I suppose it's another interesting point. Why I would, you know, would sort of suggest to people to use it. So that even if you aren't thinking of using Kotlin Multiplatform straight away, I think there's a sort of mindset maybe where it's like, okay, let's make what I'm creating Kotlin Multiplatform ready. You know, okay, I think in the future I might use Kotlin Multiplatform. I don't have any particular needs now. I have a choice now in a new project. I think it's a good reason to use Ktor and the various other libraries at that point. Say, okay, at least by doing this, I'm multiplatform ready. I can now, you know, migrate that to a shared module that's Kotlin Multiplatform.
So apart from documentation, which we are working on, but you know it's a lot and it takes time. What are your main pain points right now with Ktor?
I don't think I have any particular ones right now.
Okay, no, just stop there. Alpha. That's it. That's like, we don't need to go further. We're out of time, folks. It was great.
I guess there have been things we. You know, again, some of these were probably just down to me learning that, you know, there were certain things that we struggled with at different points that either asking Kotlin Lang or discovering a feature, you know, some stuff we were doing around sort of JWT token management and things, you know, on the server side that I sort of hadn't been aware of what capabilities were available and sort of the right approach to do, the right patterns to use. That was more sort of an education on my part.
Yeah, we're actually improving that. So we're making a marketplace where not only our features are going to be, but you can upload your own features and in a simplified way. So a lot of stuff on the roadmap for Ktor.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. Like, actually, the other thing we're doing, which is quite nice, we're using sort of a third-party library for Swagger generation. Which means that, you know, if you go to sort of a particular URL/API docs, you now get a sort of an automatically generated Swagger UI where you can try out the endpoints, you can plug in a token, see the documentation for the different endpoints, try them out, see what the JSON is, for example.
Do you want to shout out that library?
We'll
just add it to the show notes later.
I'll ping you afterwards with it. Because I've definitely recommended it. It's very, just a really nice capability.
So before we wrap this whole thing up, I actually want to tackle one more topic that is very close to my heart. We've kind of talked about it a little bit beforehand. We noted it on the side, and that is that you're also doing a bit of Compose for desktop in your applications. How was your experience there? We kind of said that it's maybe a bit of a throwback to your historical days on the desktop. How have things changed? How do you like working with it?
Oh yeah, I mean it's a fundamentally different approach. I mean, doing Windows sort of MFC type development.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
It couldn't be more different, really. You know, on so many different levels. You know, and obviously having done a little bit of Compose, obviously on mobile, the transition is very straightforward. You know. Yeah, no, it's very nice. I mean, I've used it on a couple of the projects I have. I also sort of, I came across, I mean, most of the projects, I guess, the various Kotlin multi-platform samples that you mentioned. So I've tried as much as possible to keep Kotlin people in space as minimal. I overuse this word, but minimal as possible. So when I want to try something new, I typically create a new project for it. So I have a number of different projects that sort of allow me to try out. I mentioned Apollo, GraphQL, or the Coding DB, for example, and so forth. And one of them was kind of interesting, was this Chip 8. You know, this one is sort of was a little bit different. I think Cedric, you may have seen Cedric Boost. He announced this nice project. It was Swing based, and I thought, okay, this is an interesting example. First of all, okay, can I do this in Compose? And it turned out to be very, very straightforward to do that.
Before you dive into this, could you just super quickly explain to our listeners what Chip 8 is?
Yeah, this is another sort of, I guess, throwback, because sort of slight tangent, but I guess the AJ and Matt, I would have spent a good bit of time in arcades growing up, you know, playing Space Invaders and so forth. Really about to show my age now. And so this, I think that was one of the appeals of it. This was sort of somebody had developed a sort of an emulator that mimics the, you know, the microcontroller that was used in those arcade games typically. And he had the code for, you know, Space Invaders and a number of other games. And he wrote a sort of Kotlin emulator, which is very interesting. It just occurred. It was more so than some of the other projects. This was just something I think that was a little bit of fun, really.
So chip 8 is what? It's an instruction set for that you can emulate, or is it a physical machine, or
no? It's an instruction set, at least as I understand it. You know, that emulates the sort of the instructions that, you know, that were used in those systems, the arcade systems at the time. And he wrote a Kotlin emulator, obviously, that emulated that. You could, you know, had a sort of a virtual CPU, had a sort of an abstract display and keyboard, and you know. So as an initial exercise, it was kind of interesting. I brought that over to Compose for desktop, and that turned out to be a very straightforward exercise. But of course, you know, I had to scratch the itch and create a Kotlin multi-platform version of that. you know, pulled his code into with a few small changes, Kotlin multi-platform module. And then the sort of display keyboard abstractions then were in the UI code in the Swift UI and the Jetpack Compose. And the UI was sort of, you know, the emulator generated this sort of buffer, basically display buffer, you know, which was, so, and it was just a matter of putting that onto a canvas on both Compose and Swift UI, and you had sort of something then that kind of emulated that. So like I said, it was more of a fun exercise, really. But it was an interesting, just as, yeah, on the context of desktop, you know, it was nice to see. It was sort of how quickly you could put something together like that, you know, on the desktop with Compose.
So are we going to see a Kotlin.js version of that emulator as well at some point? Thanks so much for coming on today. It was really good talking to you. And we'll see or hear all of you in the next episode of Talking Kotlin.
And if you haven't checked us out on YouTube, if you're listening to us in the car while you're commuting to nowhere, because we still don't commute, make sure you check us out on YouTube. And Seb?
Remember to like, subscribe, and hit that bell. That's best part of the job.
It's amazing. Yeah,
I think it's below, actually.
I've been working on my biceps so that you could see when I do that.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Take care and see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.